Hi, I'm Xiao. I'm here to talk about something different because we're going to talk about RISC-V's potential as a, in a pure software perspective. First of all, I didn't realize this, but back when I was writing the slides, some of my colleagues would say, your title is too long. Nobody's going to read that one. And you might not notice this one, but I didn't read my title either. The thing is, I kind of like this title, so allow me to explain why I wrote this title. First thing, I work for Cryptate, which is a blockchain company in China, and we are building the next generation blockchain called Nerverse. So if you find some of the design quite weird, please remember that I'm biased here. Some of them might be just be me being silly, but some of them are just having a blockchain focus here. The second thing is that even if we are a blockchain-focused company, we believe our work here could also be used in general purpose beyond blockchain. That's why I'm sharing here. The second thing is I like most of the talks we have here today, I'm not talking about hardware. I'm talking about RISC-V's potential as a pure software sandbox here. And finally, this is about RISC-V. Otherwise, I'm going to probably be kicked out of this room here. First thing here, a software sandbox is an isolated and untrusted environment where you run code from someone else, which is untrusted both for security and a performance reason. A security reason is that you don't want the code written by someone else to steal your money from your bank account. And from a perspective view, you don't really want the code written by someone else to mine bitcoins on your laptop. And typically, there are two kinds of software sandbox used today. One is that I believe everyone is using browser today, and most of the browsers have a JavaScript engine running on there. These days, a JavaScript engine is actually a very decent software sandbox. It runs all kinds of JavaScript code, whether they're fast or slow, whether they're secure or insecure. They're all running on your computer where the browser will also protect your computer. The second type is that these days, the cloud vendors such as Amazon or Google Cloud both have this kind of software sandbox where you just run a function, you just write a function or you write a part of code. So instead of running a whole server, running a whole operating system, it actually only runs an application. This application could be written by anyone else. So from a browser, from a cloud vendor's perspective, this code is untrusted. So they want to run this untrusted code on their platform while executing the actual user's behavior. So a typical example here is just Docker. The way Docker works is you have a native binary is running inside of Linux environment, and it uses some Linux capabilities such as isolated sandbox or C groups to guard its behavior. Guard this application to make sure this application doesn't harm the underlying operating system. So based on Docker, there's some typical products such as AWS Lambda. Actually, AWS Lambda works slightly different because it doesn't use Docker directly, but back from the behind, it shares the same behavior as Docker. And also this new contender as Cloudflare Workers. All these examples are used to run untrusted code from cloud vendor's perspective. And there obviously there's some requirements for software sandbox. So what I'm going to here first talk about is the requirement for a general purpose sandbox. Later we can see for our blockchain use case, we have some new requirements which is added on top of this general software sandbox. So obviously, first thing, you want the software sandbox to be secure. You want code to be running to be contained in the software sandbox. You don't want the code to steal your money from your laptop or something. The second thing is that you want sandbox to have a loosely determined behavior. So the laptop, the code running on one server must be identical from the code running on a different server. So if you're writing one application, you don't want this application to be resulting different behaviors from one laptop from another or from one server to another. That will be catastrophic. The third thing here is what you want the software sandbox to be fast. Otherwise, but this fast is relatively fast. You don't have to be, it doesn't have to be absolutely so fast. You only want it to be relatively fast to be able to use. And that's the behavior for a general software sandbox. Since we are a blockchain-focused company, and these days blockchain is designed to be able to run a more application than just sending money from one account to another. So for blockchain purpose, we want this software sandbox to also be strictly determinism. So for general purpose software virtual software sandbox, even though we say it has some loosely determinism behavior, there's also some variabilities. For example, if you run it on one server, you want to obtain the time of the current operating system, you get one value. And the next time you run it, the time you get, timestamp you get might be a different value. This behavior is okay on a general purpose sandbox, but on a blockchain VM, you don't want this behavior. You want every single execution of the same code running in the same environment with the same surrounding variables. So every time you run, get a current timestamp API on a blockchain VM, you want to obtain the same value. The second thing is that a blockchain VM only has a slight amount of time to be executed. So it must have a runtime cost model. Typically, when you are running this inside a Docker environment or you run it in JavaScript, you can say, I will let it run for 5 seconds. If for five seconds doesn't work, we'll just kill this program. But on a blockchain VM, 5 seconds on one VM, on one machine may be quite different from 5 seconds on a different machine. This is a behavior we really don't want. So we want to have a runtime cost mode where we can see this instruction runs for this amount of calls. And it runs this amount of calls on one machine, it must take the same amount of calls on a different machine. The third thing we want here is that a blockchain VM, one way to think about a blockchain is that it's actually just a kind of protocol or just kind of hardware. Once you deploy a blockchain there, it's extremely hard to modify it. Just think of a blockchain VM as a TCP protocol. We use it every day, but if someone wants to add a new feature to TCP protocol, that's going to be really hard because you need to upgrade every single hardware out there running TCP protocol to be able to support this new feature. The same thing happens for a blockchain. So we definitely want a blockchain VM to be future-proof. Just quoting our founder of our project here, a blockchain is actually hardware software which is hard to upgrade. There are some existing sandbox solutions we can apply to a general purpose sandbox or to a blockchain VM. Just as I mentioned above, Docker is one of them, JavaScript is a different one of them. But this thing also have their problems. Docker, as I mentioned before, is an operating system level virtualization. It just leverages Linux features to help ensure this sandbox behavior. But the problem is, if you build a Docker binary for x86, you cannot run it on an ARM CPU. If you build a Docker binary for ARM CPU, you cannot run it on x86 CPU. So it's limited by the CPU architecture of the underlying machine. On the other hand, JavaScript is a very flexible sandbox environment. You can run it on pretty much any software CPU architecture there. But the problem for it is that it is too much high level. Applying certain optimizations can be hard. Like if I want to apply vector optimization to a set of cryptographic algorithms, it's going to be very, very hard. The second thing is JavaScript is quite bloated. Luckily, there's some behavior recently in our world to combine Docker and JavaScript, which is WebAssembly. So WebAssembly is actually just a binary format, just like RISC-V, but it's still much higher level than RISC-V. It works for a stack-based virtual machine. It's actually mainly for the web adapted, but recently there's a lot of adoption in using WebAssembly in the blockchain space. And WebAssembly is actually already a spec agreed among major browser vendors. We call WebAssembly a decent attempt. We believe it's a quite good general purpose blockchain VM, but general purpose sandbox solution, but we don't believe it's a good blockchain software sandbox. Here's an example of a WebAssembly code. You have some C code compiled first to a stack machine, and then you code that stack machine representation into some binary code, which is mostly just like what we have here for RISC-V. The thing with WebAssembly is that it has some quirks comparing to things like RISC-V. First of all, it's just a software spec. It means that you only take 4 major vendors to change something to make sure WebAssembly is going to do some breaking change. The second thing, it doesn't have strictly determinism as we mentioned before. the design of WebAssembly is actually really optimized for speed. It doesn't say if we execute WebAssembly on one machine and we execute WebAssembly on a different machine, they should have exactly the same behavior. The underlying behavior may change because it only optimized for speed. So I would say WebAssembly is actually only for like best purpose determinism. The third thing is there are too many high-level features in WebAssembly. This looks quite funny if you think about the fact WebAssembly is actually designed to be a low-level stack machine. It actually contains garbage collection, and also there's a plan to add threading into WebAssembly spec. I know we also have things to enable threading in RISC-V, but let me assure you this is talking about different things. They're thinking about adding high-level threads into WebAssembly spec. This could make sense in the world of web, because in the web you want things to be able to use every single core in your laptop. But the thing is, this is going to hurt a lot when you're using a blockchain VM, when you're using WebAssembly on a blockchain VM. So the conclusion we have here is that we think WebAssembly is an okay choice for a general purpose software sandbox, but we don't believe it's a good choice for a blockchain sandbox solution. Remember, we are a blockchain purpose focused company. We have our own set of requirements we have to fulfill to make a product. Thing is, can we do better? And that's why we are here. We are building a new virtual machine just leveraging standard RISC-V instruction set as a new software sandbox solution, which is going to apply to both general software sandbox and our blockchain-focused software sandbox. And also, we're just using ELF as our binary format. So the end result is that when we are building our blockchain VM, we can just use everyday single software like GCC or LVM to compile our binary to compile our source code into a binary code and then run it on our VM. And also the one additional benefit of using RISC-V here is that we can just use real GPU cycles as the runtime cost model. So if we can just pick one CPU out there and measure the cost of each single RISC-V instruction on this CPU, and we just use that cycles directly as the runtime cost model. This is gonna scale well, and this is gonna be very future-proof. And the final thing is that like WebAssembly, we require you to ship algorithm with our code. If you want to use one GC algorithm without a code, you can just ship it in your code. If you want to plug in a different GC algorithm, this is also possible. So remember, our target is just the RISC-V standard ISA, so you can do whatever you want when you're writing the code. The thing I want to mention is that using RISC-V has some additional benefits here. So take this single C lines of code here. So if we just compile that to JavaScript, it's going to look weird, like the red one. And this thing, on modern JavaScript engine, this will map directly to native instruction. But the thing is, this looks weird, and it's just based on certain assumptions of this day's JavaScript modern engine. And this is not going to be future-proof. And the same thing applies if we compile the code to native instruction. On the left, there's x86 instructions. On the right, there's ARM instructions. No matter what instruction set we're targeting, we are losing a different set of CPU shares. On the other hand, if we're using using RISC-V here, and we just target RISC-V, this thing is we can build a VM then, and this thing is going to work on almost all CPU instruction set, and we also get this low-level optimization potential here. Also, since we're building a blockchain VM, and in blockchain VM, crypto algorithm is a very important part here. We're also thinking about leveraging VLP extensions here to make sure that we can speed up crypto algorithm as we want. And the third benefit, but not so important benefit into here is that with RISC-V, we can get real-time insight into the VM. So one example here is that when we are executing a code on the VM, we can adapt to different environments. So on a blockchain VM, when we are executing it this stage, there are two kinds of requirements. The first is how long you can execute the program. The second part is how much space you can you can use on this blockchain. So we can make sure write a contract in a way that if you have enough space, you can just store all the data you want in flat format, so you are saving CPU cycles for in exchange, saving CPU cycles, but at the cost of spending more space. But on the other hand, if your space is constrained, the code running inside the VM can detect this thing and then use some compression algorithm at the cost of more CPU cycles, but then use less space. The thing with RISC-V is that all this information you need is exposed to the script writers. They can write a script in a way that the script is going to adapt to whatever they want. The second thing is that we can enable real-time process migration here. The thing is, if you think about this, a RISC-V, I say, if we ignore most of the hardware details, it's just a bunch of CPU registers and a blob of memory space. Sorry. So what we can do is that normally when we are starting a program this day, there will be a first initialization process. What we can do is that we can put a RISC-V VM somewhere running all the initialization code here. Then we just hold the VM there and we just save the work, all the registers and save the memory address we have been written. And we just pack this thing into a single executable. And what we need to really run the code here, we just unpack this thing on different side to a different RISC-V VM instance, and we can just resume the execution there. This is something, first of all, this thing is also achievable using other software sandbox, but the thing we want to argue is that with RISC-V SA, this is going to be fast and simple and feel so natural that no everyone will feel like using it. Obviously, using RISC-V ISA also has some problem here. Our big obstacle is performance. Basically, we're emulating one ISA on top of a different ISA, so performance is going to be a big problem here. Obviously, we're drawing inspiration from somewhere. I'm not sure if Michael and Bruce are here, but if you guys can see this video, thank you so much for bringing this awesome RBA project. We draw a lot of inspiration from your project. So short recap, RVA is the first really most performant RISC-V simulator, whatever you want to call it, on x86. It really uses modern JIT compiler technology to compile RISC-V instruction directly into x86 instruction and run it on computer. According to the original paper, it can achieve like two times the runtime of a native instructions. We can apply the same technology here to use JIT to optimize our code. One thing we noticed is that due to the simplicity of RISC-V, it's actually not so hard to translate RISC-V instruction to x86 because RISC-V is so simple but yet powerful. For most of the behavior, there's only one way to implement for most of the operation, there's only one way to implement it in RISC-V. So in a JIT detector, it's not so hard to detect a pattern, apply certain optimization, and translate that into our native instructions. We have a preliminary JIT working right now, and our initial result is that we can achieve the same order of magnitude for code running in RISC-V against code running on native platform. Of course, this number is only going to get better. But in our use case, one of the best things is that we don't need a RISC-V VM to be extremely fast to be usable. Once it becomes reasonably fast, because we are only running so much code on this VM, it can be quite useful here. And actually, there's more. Because RISC-V is a hardware spec, so instead of building software VM, what we can do is that we can also attach a coprocessor on a modern computer. And when you need to run a binary on a RISC-V VM, you can just offload this binary onto the RISC-V coprocessor, run it there, and send the result back to the main x86 or whatever computer you're using on. This way, you're achieving both performance and security here. And finally, I just want to say this thing, because if you consider the new edge computing world, there's not only an user embedded device. There's also servers at the edge locations, and no matter how much we want this server to be running on RISC-V, there will still be existing servers running on x86 and ARM CPUs. What we are thinking is that if we do have a software spec running RISC-V ISA, the thing is that we can have the same code running on any device using real hardware, and also this code could also run on edge servers using this translated VM on x86 or ARM CPUs. I think what we can dream here is a better ecosystem where you're running RISC-V everywhere. It could be running a hardware, it could be running a software, but on the end, we are building a better ecosystem together. And finally, I just want to repeat this code. Blockchain is hardware software, which is hard to upgrade. Therefore, we adopt RISC-V or CKB VM because of its simplicity and flexibility. And that's all I have today. So the question is, can we just use LLVM as our abstraction layer instead of building this weird thing which translates RISC-V assembly into native assemblies? So the thing is, if you consider LLVM is still a very abstract way, it has unlimited registers and there's no memory layout thing. For general purpose VM, this might be okay. In fact, this is just what WebAssembly do. So if you look at WebAssembly, it roughly maps to LLVM. But the thing is, when we are building this thing, when we are trying to build our blockchain VM, this LLVM thing is still still coarse-grained. For example, this unlimited register is going to bring a whole lot of different problems on a blockchain VM. So the thing I want to say is that for a thing like RISC-V, everything is have an upper bound. This upper bound is very important when you're using, when you're considering a software sandbox, especially our strict software sandbox solution. But if you look at LLVM spec, it's not designed for this. It has this, it has unlimited registers, memory layout is not fixed, everything doesn't really have an upper bound. So there will be a whole different new level of security problem if we just apply that one.
So if Java JVM does not run any ARM or something lives as it can choose all as a but why only this file as a blockchain?
Actually, JVM is even higher level than LLVM, so there's a lot of things that's not fixed. If we're designing a thing that our JVM or LLVM that has fixed behavior, we're essentially designing a new virtual machine. Also, one thing I wasn't touched, if you're thinking from a programmability problem side of view, using LLVM or using JVM also both fix your programming paradigm into one set of programming languages, which is something that we don't really want to achieve on our blockchain VM. So on our VM, what we want to achieve is that we want user to be able to use any language out there they want. So in that case, a VM that looks like a real computer is really our only option here.